Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, everybody. So, my today topic is constructing the low-dimensional data representation in data analysis. I'd like to say that we first time faced this problem around 10 years ago, working for Airbus Group on the problem, on the task of shaping, good shape of airfoil. Airfoil normally is described by 57 parameters. 57, everybody knows about curse of dimensionality. This phenomena does not allow to use the conventional methods for optimization. It's too much. So, and we managed to reduce the dimensionality up to six components. After that, of course, we had to go back in the initial space just to make the interpretation of our results. It was a rather complex problem because not only we would like to preserve the geometrical proximity, but also the proximity from the point of view of some function on RP P equal 57 dimension, for instance, drag. The drag should be the same, and not only geometrical proximity, but the proximity on this, from the point of view of proximity of some function. So normal way today to avoid the phenomena of dimensionality, curse of dimensionality, is to transform high dimensional data into low dimensional data with preserving some essential properties. Data representation algorithms are used in many cases in key tasks of data analysis, data mining, data science. And here I'd like to make some examples of this transformation. For instance, let's talk about three, four key tasks from data analysis, like sample embedding. For instance, sample embedding, data space manifold and embedding and so on. First of all, geometrical approach. You know, 2 years ago, one guy called Johansson said very good sentences. Machine learning is about the shape of data. Machine learning is about the shape of data. It's true. Geometrically motivated algorithms are very often are useful to solve some initial problem from in the area of data analysis. One of the typical approach is so-called cost functions concept. So, of course, when we make the transformation of high-dimensional data in low-dimensional data, we pay some price. We lose some property. It's absolutely obvious. And the measure of this transformation is our cost function. So it means we are facing two problems. First of all, a choice of the appropriate cost function, and of course, the optimization of the chosen cost function. I'd like to tell about some typical data analysis tasks. First of all, is clustering problem, very well known clustering problem. You have data set XN. And we would like to split this data set for some groups with, in some sense, similar properties. What does it mean, similar properties? Nobody knows. It can be absolutely different for different tasks. But anyway, we think that our dimension is too high to use conventional method. So we would like to embed our sample, our initial sample, in the space RP, to embed this data set in the low-dimensional space, and in this low-dimensional space make some, let's say, conventional operations to solve this problem. But of course, this transformated data set should, faithfully represent the initial properties of our task. What does it mean? For instance, we would like to preserve the angles, the distances, or some maybe another measure of proximity between initial points. It means doesn't exist a common solution of this problem. It depends of the properties that we would like to preserve, to conserve. There's some examples of sample embedding algorithms. Multidimensional scaling, MDS. For MDS, we can show this cost function. This cost function depends on two parts. Rho, this is a distance in initial space, and h, that is the Euclidean distance in reducing space. If rho is normal Euclidean metric, MDS is equal to PCA, principal component analysis. Everybody knows what this means. Laplacian engine maps. Laplacian engine maps is some kind of cost function where we'd like to take into account just only the distances between a point, the point in epsilon neighborhood of the initial point x. So we'd like to make into account only the distances between the points that that are belonging to the epsilon ball of point x in this case. From a mathematical point of view, we are dealing with discrete analog of Laplace-Beltrami operator. In Laplace-Beltrami operator, everybody knows Stokes theorems. So, and the solution of this approach is done three or four years ago. Task number two, classification problem. Given the inputs X, as usual, data set X, label it. It means that every point from this data set is equipped by output or label lambda belonging to some classes. Sorry. I lost my slide. Okay. So, classification problem. Classification problem is different from sample embedding problem because our problem, our task is to find the label for the out of sample point on the base of initial labeled data set. The same approach. We make just not only sample embedding. in this case, we need to make the data space embedding. So it means to find some transformation RP to RQ, Q less than P. And in this case, we will call the reducing space feature space. And in this case, if you have the point X out of the sample point that we would like to find the label, in this case we can do it in the reducing space, and after that to go down and to make the same label for the H minus one from X, the initial out of sample point. So it means that this case in classification, we need not only to make the sample embedding, but we need also make the embedding of data space, initial data space. So it means reduce the dimensionality of the initial space. The most popular data model is manifold data model. What does it mean? Data space is Q-dimensional manifold. Normally is a Q-dimensional manifold, but embedded in the ambient P-dimensional space. It's number one. Number two, the points are selected independently, each of each other, according to some probability measure mu. The manifold assumption is based on following empirical fact. In normal life, high dimensional real world data lie on some unknown but low dimensional data manifold embedded in ambient high dimensional observation space. So, and our goal is to find this manifold data. We have just only data set, and we would like to reconstruct the manifold data, taking into account that our main proposal is that normally is the point of this data set X is generated from Q-dimensional space. It's empirical fact. It's called manifold data model. Normally, our goal is to extract some unknown properties from initial data set. Let's go to third example: reduced data analysis problems. Reduced data analysis problems. When your initial task is prognosis optimization, we would like to reduce dimensionality up to from initial data set X to feature space H. And to solve our problem in reduced space RQ. As an example, this approach, very well known paper of Mr. Chen. It's called electricity price curve modeling and forecasting by manifold learning. For instance, we have so-called our price of electricity. Of course, it's 24 vector for every day, and we would like to make forecast. If you know all curves, it's called curve. For some days, 24 is too much. It's too much to use conventional methods of forecasting. So I don't know. I don't explain why, but Q equals 4 was selected as an upper dimension of the manifold. This allowed to use following manifold running forecasting algorithm, so it means conventional algorithm, just for forecasting. But in this case, you have to come back. You have to return in the initial space, and it is rather it's not so simple. So to make the forecasting to use conventional techniques for forecasting in the dimensionality 4, it's not so complex. But to go back. To go back in initial space, it's rather complex. So, it's one of the first public example of in the same time solving two problems. One is embedding problem, and another reconstructing problem, because we should go back after the solving our problem is in reduced space. Manifold reconstructing problem. Given an input data set sampled from a q-dimensional data, it's very important. We think that our data set X data manifold is q-dimensional manifold, embedded in p-dimensional Euclidean space, and manifold reconstructing problem consists of two interrelated mappings. One, one is embedding mapping. So we just told about it. And another one is reconstructing mapping. Because when I said, as I said, we should go back, always go back to reconstruct our manifold in p-dimensional space. Let x theta or r theta of x is the reconstructed point. It's final result. So normally you have two mappings. Mapping H, it's embedding mapping, and mapping G, it's reconstructing mapping. And normally x theta is the result of two transformations, of two mappings consequently. One is embedding, another is reconstruction. Of course, the quality of our mapping is the error between initial point x and reconstructor point x theta. It's a measure of quality of solution theta at the point x. Of course, at the point x, not in general. Now I'd like to tell about one very simple reason, very simple idea. I would say obvious idea. The tangent space in initial point at the reconstructed point should be rather close to get a good solution. It should be rather close. The idea is absolutely obvious. Two spaces should be rather close. This is the main idea for our algorithm, to build the couple of mapping H and mapping J such a way that the tangent manifold for initial point and reconstructed point should be close for every manifold, every initial manifold. Technically, I'd like to introduce the notion of generalization ability. Generalization ability, this is error between initial point and reconstructed point, but on the whole manifold. The measure should be chosen differently, but the error, it is an error for all manifold, not only for some point x. For a point of data set, it can be directly computed, and for the outer sample point, it should be estimated. Upper and lower bands for local generalization ability of for an arbitrary solution theta will be was estimated in our paper. But once more, the main idea is rather simple. The greater the distance between the tangent spaces to the data manifold n and the reconstruction of manifold m theta at the point x and m theta respectively, the lower the local generalization ability of the solution theta becomes. It's absolutely clear, it's can say obvious. On the basis of this evident idea was built up the algorithm which provides the proximity of initial manifold and tangent proximity, the proximity of tangent space in each point. The main idea of the algorithm is to construct two mapping H and G on the basis of proximity. The initial tangent space is not really tangent space. It's the span of Jacobian, reduced Jacobian. It means we give the first q eigenvectors. With biggest values, and on the base of these q vectors, we are constructing span of Jacobian. It's not exactly the span of Jacobian; it's some estimation of span of Jacobian. And so it means that we know the node of Jacobian. Of unknown function, we know the point, we know the Jacobian at this point, and we would like to build up two mapping on this base, such a way that Jacobian, the tangent space, will be closed. When I said it's the idea is rather simple, we called it tangent bundle proximity. Tangent bundle, why tangent bundle? Because in topology, tangent bundle is a composition of point x and tangent space in this point for all manifold. It's normally it's called tangent bundle of a manifold M. So this method is called also tangent bundle of manifold. Tangent bundle manifold. I don't want to tell a lot of details of algorithms because the main idea is rather simple, but from the point of view of but computationally is rather difficult, and this point I'd like to mention the result of our hero of the day, Boris Polyak. Due to this result, we managed to align all our bases. Because when I said that we reduce Jacobian only for coup vectors. Unfortunately, if you don't make the alignment, you can see the picture like this. You see here it's different bases. But our goal is to preserve some smooth changing of the bases, and for that we needed the method proposed by Boris Polyak 2 years ago, the method of alignment. This method of alignment allows us to get the smooth solution. Smooth solution, it means smooth in the sense of order of basic vector, not only space but basic vector. Another optimization problem is to find this matrix Vx, which allows us to make this alignment smoothly. So it's also in this case we also use the proposal of Mr. Polyak, Professor Polyak. He proposed certain effective numerical scheme, which allows us to get a result. Finally. So this is a small short explication why it's really obvious, because you have to understand that practically we know the Jacobian in both case, and it means we immediately are dealing with only second part of Taylor theory. So finally, one theoretical result: the proposed algorithm called Grassmann-Steffel agent maps has optimal convergence rate as n tends to infinity. This is error. The error is optimal when n tends to infinity. And of course here all these reasons are in this case, the distance between M reconstructed and M initial is Hausdorff distance, and for Hausdorff distance, this convergence rate is optimal. At the end, let me show you some numerical experiments. JC here is our algorithm, Grassmann-Steffel agent maps, and there is some very well known algorithm for spiral. Here is the algorithm for spiral. You know that any formula better than in other algorithms. Practically the same for Swiss roll. This figure is Swiss roll. When I said the manifold data model is we generated the points according some probability measure mu, and after that we try to reconstruct the manifold. Sorry. The same thing for Swiss roll with changed curvature. Practically, the result is the same. We are much better than in other algorithms. And even in isometric case, when we are talking only about about sample embedding with preserving of distances, it's called isometric, our result also always better. So, of course, we can use this algorithm not only for dimensionality reduction, but also for different tasks like regression, for example, like classification, clustering, so all classical things. No, I can also show you the numerical result comparing with creaking. So you see that it's much better. This is the result of creaking. It's our result. It's initial function. So even in the sample cases, we are really better. Same thing for two dimension. This is the creaking result, and this is our result, this is the initial result. So, that's all. Thank you for your attention.